HarperCollins presents The Fallen by Michael Wood, read by Stephanie Beattie. Chapter 1. Tuesday, the 7th of December, 2010. Andrea Barnes should have been winding down her work duties, handing everything over to her second in command and making sure they knew what to do in her absence, not hurtling through the streets of Sheffield on a mercy dash for a man she didn't even like. She should have known this would happen. Every time she had some time off or was preparing to go on holiday, something always spoiled it. She was beginning to think all those months at spinning class, firming up her bum to fit into a 125-pound bikini, had been a waste of time. Would she ever feel golden sand between her toes? This time, Iain Kilbride had failed to show for work again. So a replacement driver had to be found at short notice, which would cost the company extra money. This also meant that a coachload of pensioners would be late setting off for a tinsel and turkey Christmas lunch in Leeds. Under normal circumstances, Andrea would have left a note with her assistant to fire Iain if he dared to show his face while she was soaking up some winter sun. But, despite Claire Wilkins being a wizard at admin, she was lousy at discipline. Iain would have to be fired face to face, and that required a manager. Without slowing down, without indicating, Andrea turned left into Staley Lane. She returned the two-fingered salute she received from the prick in the Audi behind and turned left again into the private car park of Hallam Grange Close. The concrete block of flats was nothing special, soulless boxes for the divorced and the widowed. Pathetic window boxes and limp-hanging baskets tried to add a dash of colour to the grey, but it was a feeble effort. At this time of year, and in these temperatures, everything was dead. Andrea parked her Vauxhall next to Iain's Skoda and climbed out. There was a bitter chill in the air, and a stiff breeze cut through her polyester uniform. She couldn't wait for her holiday to begin. Goodbye, freezing Sheffield, and hello, sunny California. She had checked the weather over breakfast, and it was currently in the mid-20s in Pasadena. Sheffield wasn't even close to double figures. She marched to the main entrance and pressed the buzzer for the ground floor flat. She waited. Andrea was well known for her impatience and was seething well before the echo of the buzzer had carried away on the breeze. She buzzed again, leaving her finger pressing hard on the button, her fingertip turning white. An elderly man in a dressing gown and walking with a frame slowly came into view through the toughened glass of the front door.
"Do you have to do that? I can hear it right through my flat. He's obviously not in."
"He obviously is," Andrea shouted back, "because his car is still here."
"I can't let you in."
"Why not?"
"You could be anyone."
"I'm his boss. I want to see if he's all right."
It wasn't technically true, but the old man didn't need to know that.
"Have you got any ID?"
"Bloody hell! Who do you think I am, a suicide bomber?"
"You can't be too careful."
"Oh, for God's sake," she muttered under her breath.
Andrea rifled around in her handbag for her purse. Opening it, she found as many forms of ID as she could.
"Take your pick. Driver's licence, work pass, credit card, gym membership, another credit card, Boots Advantage card, library card, Waterstones club card, credit card, Nectar card, donor card. Will any of those do?"
The old man opened the door.
"There's no need to be sarcastic."
"You know what your trouble is? You've got too much time on your hands," Andrea said, barging past the elderly man.
As she passed the open door to his flat, she felt a blast of nuclear heat coming from within. She headed straight for Iain's flat. Andrea knocked on the door hard with her leather-gloved fist. She didn't wait for a reply, but knocked again harder.
"You'll have the door off,"
the old man said, moving slowly towards her with his walking frame. From the floor above, a tall young man with a shaved head was coming down the stairs, putting a knitted hat on.
"What's all the banging about?"
"Have you seen Iain lately?" Andrea asked.
"Not since last night."
"Did he say anything?"
"No, I don't really know him. We say hello, that's about it."
She knocked again, louder this time.
"Iain, it's Andrea. Can you open up, please?" she shouted,
her voice resounding off the walls in the foyer. Andrea crouched down and looked through the letterbox. She immediately screamed and fell backwards onto the cold tiled floor.
"What's the matter?" the young man asked.
"It's Iain. He's on the floor."
"Are you sure?"
"Yes, I'm sure. He's just lying there."
The man crouched and lifted the letterbox up.
"There's nobody there," he said, looking at Andrea with a confused frown. "Of course there's somebody there. I know what I saw."
"What did you see?"
Andrea had a hand on her chest and was breathing deeply. Her face was white.
"I saw Iain on the floor. His eyes were wide open."
"On the floor in the hallway?"
"No, in the living room."
"The living room door is closed."
"No, it's open. I saw through the door and Iain was on the floor. I could see the dining table behind him."
"The door is closed and there's nobody in the hallway," the man said, looking through the letterbox once again.
"I didn't imagine it," she said, looking between the young man with the woolen hat and the old man with the walking frame.
They seemed to be frowning, judging her.
"I'm not lying."
"Have another look," the old man said.
"I'm not looking through there. He's dead, I'm telling you."
The young man held up his hands to silence them before the exchange became too heated.
"I'll go around the back and have a look through the living room window. You stay here."
Andrea watched wide-eyed as the young man left the building. She smiled at the older man, a sympathetic, I'm not crazy kind of smile. He returned the awkward gesture but started to shuffle away. He couldn't get back into his flat fast enough. The door slammed closed and Andrea heard the rattling of the security chain being fastened. She was alone in the hallway. There was an underlying smell of cold and damp. The bile green floor tiles were scuffed and in need of a good scrub or replacing completely. The walls had once been cream, but over time had turned to nicotine yellow. The lighting was poor and headache-inducing. Why did Iain live here? It was depressing. The front door to Ian's flat burst open, making Andrea jump. She turned around, half expecting to see Iain in his dressing gown making an excuse for not turning up to work. She was shocked to see the young man in the woolly hat, whose name she didn't know.
"I think you'd better call the police."
Chapter 2. Matilda Darke opened her eyes and for a brief moment had no idea where she was. Then it dawned on her. She was no longer in her room in a king-sized bed with fitted wardrobes and an ensuite wet room. She was in a cramped caravan, sleeping on a converted sofa where the only privacy was a beige curtain. Suddenly, this did not seem like such a good idea. The curtain was pulled back and she sat up. The man at the foot of her bed was holding two mugs of tea on a tin tray. There was a tiny vase with a single red rose in it.
"Did you sleep well?" he asked with a hopeful smile.
"No. I had springs sticking in me where springs should not be sticking."
"Oh. It won't be for long."
"Really? We'll be back in our house before Christmas, will we?"
"Hardly," he scoffed. "Christmas is only 3 weeks away." Matilda rolled her eyes. "Look on the bright side. We'll have the house of our dreams when it's finished. A gorgeous sunken bathtub. Dressing room just for you. No more nasty wardrobes. A walk-in pantry in the kitchen. A real log burner in the sitting room. This time next Christmas will be bliss."
Matilda smiled. It was difficult to be angry with James Darke for too long. All he had to do was smile that perfect smile, twinkle those ice blue eyes, and she'd agree to anything.
"Will you buy me diamonds next Christmas?" "I'll buy you diamonds every Christmas."
He placed the tray on the only available floor space and crawled into bed with his wife. He leaned in and kissed her passionately on the lips.
"Morning breath," she said, turning away.
"I don't mind."
"I do. Besides, I've got to get to work."
"Call in sick. Let's pretend we're children of the earth and we're travelling the country in a horse-drawn caravan, making love at every stop."
"Nice idea, Stud," she smiled. "First of all, I can't call in sick as I've only had the job a week. Secondly,
Nice to see you finally admit this is a caravan. What happened to the Winnebago I was promised?
I've had to order one from Norway. It should be here next week.
We do have motorhomes in this country, you know.
Have you tried to find a company that will lift one over our house into the back garden without charging an arm and a leg for insurance?
They're going to drop it on the house, aren't they?
The British probably would. The Norwegians wouldn't.
Please tell me you know what you're doing.
I know what I'm doing.
Now say it like you mean it. Matilda struggled to wash herself in a shower the size of an airing cupboard. As she toweled herself dry, she knocked over her coffee cup and banged her head 3 times on the ceiling. This was definitely not going to work.
James, where's the red suitcase?
She called out to him in the next room.
Was it really a different room when the wall was so thin you could put your fist through it?
What red suitcase?
The red suitcase on our bed that I asked you to bring down because it was too heavy. There was no reply, though she might have heard a mumbled, shit.
Late for work. Got to go. Love you. Bye.
James called, slamming the door behind him.
James Dart, get back here right now, Matilda called out after him. That had all my work clothes in it.
Chapter 3. The new murder investigation team, MIT, at South Yorkshire Police had a brand new open plan office with ergonomic desks, state-of-the-art computers, soothing decoration, and potted plants to increase productivity and maintain a calm and healthy atmosphere. The one failing was the heating system, which looked and sounded like it had been salvaged from the wreck of the Titanic. Detective Chief Inspector Matilda Darke was in charge of the MIT and all the officers working there. It took 6 months of interviews, shadowing, presentations and training courses before the job was finally offered to her. When ACC Masterson gave her the news, she tried to remain professional. The plan had been to nod, give a brief smile and thank the ACC for having faith in her. Unfortunately, she briefly lost control, punched the air and almost grabbed her boss in a bear hug until she remembered where she was. She tried to cover up her emotional outburst, but it was too late. Never mind. She pulled open the glass door to the MIT suite and was hit in the face by the smell of new carpet.
Bloody hell, Sian, open a window, will you? It took me all night to get rid of the headache from the smell of this carpet.
Open a window? It's freezing, DS Sian Mills said. Besides, it's not that bad over here. Aaron dropped his bolognese yesterday, which has taken the newness off it.
Oh, well, when he gets in, ask him to drop his breakfast in my office, will you?
Sian smiled.
Coffee?
I'd love one.
What are you doing with that lot? Matilda asked, pointing at a plastic bag full of chocolate bars.
It was an idea of Stuart's last night. A woman in his office has a snack drawer. You helped yourself to whatever you fancy, but you have to replace it with something similar.
I like that idea. I often need a chocolate rush in the afternoons.
Well, as you're the boss, you can have a twirl on the house, she said, tossing one to her.
Thanks.
So, have we settled in now? Matilda asked, looking at the white boards, which held details of the cases they were currently working on.
I think so. I know the desks were strategically placed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.